Amen. God is good
all the time.
Amen. You may be seated. Our ushers are coming forward at this time, and they will distribute our registration of attendance pads. We'd ask you to fill those out and pass them down the pew. Know the names of those persons you're worshiping beside or around today, and don't fail to greet one another following the service. It's our prayer that the hospitality of Christ will be experienced by everyone in this place. If you're visiting with us today, we're so thankful for that. You're our honored guest this morning. And we want to encourage all of our first-time visitors following the service to go to our connections table, which will be just outside the sanctuary. And there we have a gift that we'd like to share with all of our first-time visitors. And again, thank you for being with us in worship. Now, I'm noticing a few new ushers and greeters and folks all around the campus today. And we are so very thankful for the many people who've signed up to help us with our hospitality here at Lover's Lane. We're so thankful for you. I do want to call our attention to the back of the bulletin where we have listed there the opportunities that we have in coming days and weeks ahead for ministry and outreach. I want to first say that you may have seen a red folder around the campus that has all of our different classes and groups that are starting in coming days. So I would say that if you're interested in getting into a group that will meet for several weeks or for a couple of weeks or a women's group or a men's group, we have a group for you. And we hope that you will find a way to participate. Those groups will be starting in next week, and we look forward to great participation in those groups. I do call your attention to the fact that September outreach will focus on the North Dallas Shared Ministry, and we'll be bringing our canned goods to church and place them in those blue containers, and we'll be taking those at the end of the month to the all-important ministry, Dallas Shared Ministries. Take note of all of the different activities going on in the life of the church and find a place that will feed your soul and will grow you spiritually. May God bless us as we continue our worship. Let's stand and sing.
We pray in the name of the one who holds all things.
thank you to our sanctuary choir for the beautiful music today. Today is a Sunday, a holiday Sunday, and we have a theme for the day. It's called Throwback Sunday. In Crosswalk, they're singing some of the old contemporary songs, and they asked me to preach an old sermon, one of my favorites, and I said, hey, yay. And today I want to preach one that I wrote 37 years ago. It's called Job and Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe, and I've preached it before here. But it's about the book of Job and the story of Job, which is wisdom literature in our Bible. And basically, that book is about the question, why do bad things happen to good people? And the questions of why that sometimes we entertain, realizing that we don't always get those answers. Today I want to talk about the story of Job, and before I read the text, it's going to be in the second chapter of Job. You can turn to that text. I want to share with you a little bit about how this story is set up. I like to call it a poetry sandwich is what it is. It's about 40 plus chapters, but it begins with prose in the first three chapters, and it ends with prose, and then it has nearly 40 chapters of poetry in the middle that's basically dealing with this question of why. We know the story of Job. Job was known as a blameless and upright fella, and he had quite a spread for a blameless and upright fella. He had, as the scripture tells us, 7,000 sheep. He had 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 she-donkeys, not counting the he-donkeys. You know he had he-donkeys. But he also had 10 children. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. We know very little about Job's kids. We only know that they really did enjoy a party. They may have been the original party animals, but we know when they had a party that Job, he felt like he needed to pray for their forgiveness. So he would oftentimes make a sacrifice and cover himself with ashes and sackcloth. He would sit and he would pray for his children. Now, following these parties, in Job's praying, Job was still known by God as a blameless and upright fellow, and he was so admired by God. And we know the story of Job is kind of a figurative story. We know that we're talking about a story where God in the story is talking to Satan, and God is bragging about Job. Have you seen my servant Job? How blameless and upright he is. And Satan retorts, well, yeah, he's got everything he wants. He was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. You take away his things, God, and you'll see that he'll curse you. And God said, I don't take away from people. But Satan says, I will. And so the next thing we hear in the story is that we hear the clamoring of Job's servants coming in to speak to Job. And the first one comes in from the north 40 and says, Job, your oxen, your donkeys, your camels, and your servants were all stolen. Your servants were actually put to the sword. I'm the only one who survived to tell you. And then a servant comes in from the south 40 and says, Job, you won't believe it, but fire came down from heaven and it burned up all of your sheep and it consumed all of your servants. I'm the only one who lived to tell you the story, and I'm singed. And then a man came from town and said, Job, you might better pull up a chair. Your kids were having their latest party in town. They were all gathered in one house, and a wind blew, and it blew the house down, and all of your children, all 10 of your children, are dead. Now, that was a pretty bad day, wouldn't you think? A tough day for Job would be a tough day for anyone, and yet it says in Scripture that Job did not curse the Lord, and he remained faithful. We pick up with the story of Job in the second chapter of Job, beginning with the 7th verse. If you'll turn with me in Scripture, let's stand for the reading of God's Word. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the head of the crown of his head. And he took a potsherd and with which to scrape himself, and he sat among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die." That's pretty uplifting. But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women speak. Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all of this, Job did not sin with his lips. He thought about it, but he didn't sin with his lips. Now, when Job's three friends heard of this evil that had come upon him, they came each from their own place: Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite. They made an appointment together to come to condole with Job, with him, and comfort him. And when they saw him from afar, they did not recognize him. And they raised their voices and wept. And they rent their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads toward the heavens. And they sat with him on the ground 7 days and 7 nights. And no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his suffering was great, very great. After this, Job opened his mouth and he cursed the day of his birth. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Now, being a East Texas born rural child of the 60s, I need to confess this morning I cut my teeth on rock and roll and country music. And I like rock and roll, and I appreciate classical music, and I enjoy jazz, and I love our sanctuary choir. Yeah. But I love country music. Now, I'm talking about the old stuff. Now, let me be the first to admit that the old stuff, these songs about barroom brawls and drunken stupors and cheating, are not too edifying. But whether the songs are about soldiers or winos or street singers or prostitutes or divorced daddies or unwed mothers, homesick drifters or prodigal children, or a man stricken with sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head, there is a common theme. And Job's story has all the makings of a good country song. This morning, I want to begin with a question. Have you ever been to Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe? Has anybody here ever been there to Rosalie's joint? Anybody? Anybody? When I was in seminary, throwback to seminary, back in the early 1980s, I was in Kansas City. Tammy and I were, and the wheels were coming off of the steel industry. There were a lot of out-of-work steel workers in Kansas City. And one of my professors, a man named Tex Sample, who hailed from Mississippi, he taught us a class called Blue Collar Ministry. He'd written a book by that name. He also taught a class called White Soul, which was about country music, being the stories of the experience of working class people. I remember one day in class, he said, "If I hear one more sermon based on Bridge Over Troubled Waters, I think I'm going to throw up." So after hearing that, I started thinking and praying about writing a sermon based on a country song. I just didn't know which one.
Well, at the church we worked at, there was a custodian there, and he was a former steel worker, had lost his job, so he was working at the church. And on the weekends, he would play country music and sing with his band. And Tammy and I'd oftentimes go and listen to him sing. And I told him about my plight, wanting to write a sermon for my professor on a country song. And he said, "I've got just a song for you, preacher." I said, "What is it?" He said, "It's a song called Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe." He said it was recorded by Bobby Bear. But he said it was first printed as a poem and it had 50 verses. And he said it came out in Playboy magazine. I said, "Whoa." So he brought me a copy of the song, not of the magazine, I must say. But sure enough, 50 verses of this song. And then I saw at the top it was written by Shel Silverstein. Do you know who that is? Shel wrote The Giving Tree. He wrote The Missing Piece. He wrote Where the Sidewalk Ends. And I didn't know it, but he wrote country music. He wrote country lyrics. And he was featured in this article. And these 50 verses that Bobby Bear picked up and recorded, but the song was too long to ever be played on the radio. And so it's only on one of his obscure albums. And I got the album from my friend and listened to it, and I said, "That's the one. Do you want to hear the song?" Fear not, I'm not going to sing 50 verses. It's 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The onions are frying and the neon is bright and the jukebox is starting to play. The sign on the wall says, "In God we trust. All others you have to pay." It's 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. Short order cook with his mama tattoo is turning them hamburgers slow. The eggs over easy and the whole wheat down. Did y'all want your coffee to go? He never once dreamed as a rodeo star that he'd wind up here today. At 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. There's a tall, skinny gal in a booth in the back, wearing jeans and a second-hand fur. She's been to the doctor, she called up a man, and wondered just where she could turn. She stares at her coffee, she looks toward the ceiling. God, it's a strange place to pray. At 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. Poetry about real human experience. That's what Rosalie's joint's about, and that's what the story of Job is about. And a real human experience is what we're about. I remember when I was first starting out in ministry, I was appointed, one of my early appointments was to First United Methodist Church in Houston, and we were right downtown. We were at the corner of Main and Clay Street, and this was in the the mid-1980s, and there were a lot of folks on the street, lots of homeless people, a lot of mentally ill homeless people on the street, and they would find their way every day to our church. So the associate pastors were assigned a day where we were on call, and if there was somebody who needed us to talk to them, then we were the ones who would come and hear their stories. One day the receptionist called me when I was on call, and she said, there's a man down here, and he seems to be awfully angry. He's obviously mentally disturbed, and he's wanting to see a pastor, and he has a very strange request. And I said, okay, I'll be down. She said, you better bring some help. So one of our associates, who was my age, his name was Paul Wilkie. He was the son of Bishop Wilkie, who wrote the Disciple Bible Study that some of you have taken. And Paul had a gift. Paul was 6 feet 10 inches tall. Just the person to go down and meet the man in the lobby. So we rode the elevator down, and there we found the man, much as he'd been described to us. He was so anxious, and he was pacing, and he was angry, and he said, look, I don't need your money. I don't want any food. I don't need a place to stay. All I want from you men is I want 10 minutes with God. Face to face, he said. I want to be speaking to God. Can you give me 10 minutes with God? I don't think they taught us that in seminary. If they did, I was asleep. And Paul and I looked at each other, and we didn't know what to do. We started talking to him, and that wasn't at all what he wanted. He said, look, I don't want to hear you talk. I want 10 minutes with God. I said, I don't know how to do that. I can't give you 10 minutes with God. I wished I could, but I just don't know how to do that. I don't know if I can help you. But I said, we would love to pray with you. He said, okay. We went into the chapel. He said, I have a demon. He said, this demon has taken away my wife and my family. This demon's taken away my job. This demon's taken away my health. I have a demon, and I want not to have a demon. That's why I want 10 minutes with God. Both of us had failed the casting out demons class as well. Can we pray with you? And we prayed, I don't know what we prayed. We babbled a prayer. But I think he knew we were sincere. I actually think he felt kind of sorry for us. And he left us still emotionally disturbed, still with a demon, but with a little more peace because he'd been with people who really were doing all we needed to do. And that was to pray. And you know, until I can cast out demons, I'm going to pray for compassion and the ears to listen to the needs of others, a mind to reason and a will to act, and a love to share the good news of our compassionate God. You want to go back to Rosalie's for a little bit?
There's an old dollar bill on the frame on the wall, the first one that Rose ever made. It was once worth a dollar a long time ago, but like Rose, it's starting to fade. She's back at the register, a dreaming of someone, and just how it'd been if he'd stayed. It's 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. Stoop-shouldered man and his frizzy-haired woman, it's strange how their eyes never meet. He's playing the pinball, she's fixing a blanket for the kid who's asleep on the seat. He's out of work and she's putting on weight. They never did have much to say. It's 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The waitress, Darlene, she sits at the counter, paint her fingernails blue. The short order cook yells, "Move it or lose it," and pick up this order of stew. One day a rich, handsome man will walk in and carry her far, far away. From 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe.
But you just want me to quit, but I'm going to continue on. Tammy's and my niece, Megan, was a fantastic young person who lost her short bout with cancer a couple of weeks ago. She was funny and positive and made an impact. That's a picture of her right there. Now, she's making some homemade ice cream with one of her Uncle Stan's first bags from our commercial ice machine in Chandler, Texas, and she's just giving me the old thumbs up there. We took a couple of family trips that we've remembered in these past few weeks. My father was a pharmacist, and he would take our extended family on pharmaceutical conventions, and we didn't go to the convention. We just went for the fun. One to Washington, D.C. that we remembered, and another to Disneyland, and we have had some big laughs over that in the last few days, and in time, those laughs will bring more joy to our hearts than grief. Now, she was a great softball player. In fact, the year that our son, Zach, and Megan were seniors, he was an all-state baseball player, and she was an all-state softball player. Zach ended up playing for Southwestern University, and Megan went to Oklahoma, where she played for Southwestern, Oklahoma State University. And at Southwestern, Megan, she met a handsome lineman on the football team, and he was a country boy from Western Oklahoma, and he drove heavy equipment, hauled hay, had cows. I remember her saying, "Uncle, you're going to really like him." And I did like Jonathan, do like Jonathan. I love Jonathan. And it was my privilege to preside over their wedding on August the 10th, 2009. And on their 10th wedding anniversary, Megan was just a few days away from her death. 10 years they'd been married. You know, she knew she wanted to be a coach. And she landed a job right out of college at UT Tyler, where she helped take that team to the national playoffs. And then she got a coaching job in the little town of Bullard outside of Tyler. And the team wasn't very good when she went there, and it was pretty doggone good when she left. In fact, they were pretty deep into the state playoffs this year. But the one she influenced the most were not just the softball girls, but her two children, Ella, who's just starting first grade, and Davis, who's four. They knew their mother's love, and their parents, Jonathan and Megan, were quite the team. Now, Megan did take her team deep into the playoffs this year, but we were told that she was having a little pain in her stomach, and she said she was going to get that taken care of as soon as the season was over. And when she did, they found a terribly metastasized cancer. She found out in May, and on August the 14th, she died. Many of you prayed for her and our family during that time, and I want to say thank you. It's been a tough summer. And her dying caused all of us to feel quite helpless. I heard from many of our family members. I spoke the words myself. I wished I could trade places with Megan, but we know life doesn't work like that. My sister Jill and my brother-in-law Kyle are true champions in my book, along with her husband Jonathan, of course, and she has a friend, Abby, and Abby's an oncology nurse, and Abby sat by her side so many nights, and the entire last week of her life, Abby was right there for her every need. And tears are still pretty close to the surface. My brother-in-law Kyle and I spent a couple of hours on my mom and dad's porch last week, and we both needed the time. He didn't need me to say very much, but he did need to talk, and I needed to listen. We talked about something I'd said on the night of the visitation. I said, now people are going to come through here, and more than 1,000, they say 1,500 people came through the visitation that night, and I said, you're going to hear some awful theology tonight. Somebody's going to come through and say, well, God needed another angel, I guess. What kind of theology is that? That God would need another angel? That God even needs angels? That God turns human beings into angels? I mean, what kind of theology is that? But I said, don't worry. They don't know what to say. They're just trying to comfort you, and they don't know what to say. They don't mean anything bad by it. But don't you believe it. Don't believe it. God doesn't cause pain to come into our lives. God doesn't desire that health be taken away from us. He said something that, of course, I could say right there with him. He said, I've asked myself so many times, why? And I still don't really have an answer. Me too, I said. I know that we're going to have to wait till we get to heaven to know some of these answers. But faith is what we hold to in times like these. Faith in a God who is good and all the time, and who was the first to shed a tear when Megan died and when she was diagnosed. And you know, until we have all the answers, you know, sometimes all we can do is just be with another and pray for compassion and the ears to listen to the needs of others and a mind to reason and a will to act and a love to share the good news of a compassionate God. You know, the world's crying out for a compassionate God and for a caring human response. Job's friends who came on the scene, the reason we have nearly 40 chapters of the story of Job is because when Job's friends come on the scene, they sit with him for 7 days, not saying a mumbling word, and then when they do speak, Job wishes they hadn't have. Because all they could say was, what did you do to make God do this to you? What What did you do to have God curse you like this? Job knew that was not his God, even though he didn't have the answers. And finally, after this time with his friends who were constantly trying to fix things and trying to find out what Job had done to bring all of this about, finally, Job says, enough. I just want some time with God. I want 10 minutes with God. And God accommodates his request. And God, in essence, says, where were you when I formed this earth? Where were you when I cast the stars in place? And at the end, what God is saying, you will not know all the answers, but you can trust me to redeem the worst of circumstances. And as we know the end of the story, that's exactly what happens. It doesn't always happen for us the way it happened for Job, and that all of his wealth and a new family was restored. But so many of us know that we can pray to a God who wants to heal us, who wants us to feel that compassion that is his, and wants us to sometimes be the conveyors of that compassion, to be the conduits of his love. We see the compassionate God in the person of Jesus. Love, welcome the stranger. Love, visit the prisoner. Love, heal the sick. Love, feed the hungry. Love, clothe the naked. Love, love, love. I would that we could fix things and say just the right thing that makes it right. But until we can, we need to pray for compassion and the ears to listen to the needs of others and a mind to reason and a will to act and a love to share the good news of a compassionate God. Have you been to Rosalie's? You have. And God calls us to go back today. And the onions are frying, and the neon is bright, and the jukebox is starting to play. And it's 2 in the morning on a Saturday night at Rosalie's Goodies Cafe.
Well, church, we may not be in Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe, and it may not be 2 o'clock on Saturday night. But you know what? We're just like those people, of course. People who are human and real and authentic. And we know that like them, we need help from someplace beyond ourselves. And when we're able to come forward for Holy Communion, we receive that help. Everyone is welcome. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Pray with me. We confess, O Lord, that we love attention. We are pleased when people single us out for something good we have done, for some outstanding trait or act of kindness. We revel in the light, but the seductive light too often captures us and we seek its brightness and glory, and turn our backs on others in need. We have been given many gifts, but we have failed to use them to help others and to serve you. Forgive our vanity and greed. Heal our wounded and aching souls. Place us again on the pathway of peace and hope that is your true way to life. For we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Church, receive the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Beloved, may we turn and continue this act of worship on page 13 of our hymnal as we share these words appropriate to this Sunday. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, sovereign of the ages, whose strong and loving arm encompass the universe. For with your eternal word and Holy Spirit, you are forever one God. Through your word, you created all things and called them good. And in you we live and move and have our being. When we fell into sin, you did not desert us. You made covenant with your people Israel and spoke to your teachers and prophets. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is Jesus Christ, who called you Abba, Father. And as a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embrace the people as your own and fill them with a longing for peace that would last and for justice that would never fail. In Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and offered a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the whole world and destroyed the power of sin and death. You raise from the dead the same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and pours upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night in which he met with death, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, blessed it, gave thanks to you, gave it to the disciples and said, Take and drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Drink this in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice. In union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith, saying, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by Christ's blood. As the grains and the grape were once dispersed in the fields are now united on this table in bread and wine. So may we and all your people be gathered from every time and place into the unity of your eternal household and feast at your table forever. through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And let the people say,
Amen.
Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is the sharing in the body of Christ. Yes. And the cup on which we give thanks is the sharing in the blood of Christ. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come and receive the body of Christ.
one of our associates of the Gillen family, Reagan and Scott. Well, this past Wednesday, a new addition was in their family, 7 pounds, 10 ounces, boy named Jude Parker. So Stan covered their service this morning. And we certainly add our gratitude for the Gillen family, and thanks be to God for Jude Parker. Would you receive this benediction? Beloved, we have been at Rosie's Cafe Good Eat at one particular time in our season of life, and we know that the presence of God come to us in ways which we do not expect, but we know that the presence of God is love, and may we so offer that presence to one another, the love of God, the compassionate ear, the listening heart, the mind that reasons, and the will to act. May we so be blessed as we share in the good news of Christ. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and let the people say, Amen.
We want to thank you for worshiping with us today and for participating in every way. You can continue to participate by joining us here at Lover's Lane or being involved in some of the ministries that you've heard about or that you've seen on our website. We also thank you for your generosity, and there's a way that you can give to this program, and you see that give button on the screen, and we do appreciate every gift that we get because that makes this ministry possible. Thank you so much, and hope to see you next week.